Try again, say OK, and then go to the file, show genome, yeah, choose say ligands, OK. The next step will be you take a gene, yeah, take another organism, you show the next one, show Genome Explorer, and this way you can take the C. elegans, or if you want to take a plant, or biopsies or something. Huh? So the idea is now that you would have a gene that you just pick yourself, and then you should open your browser. So I hope it will work, because if everybody goes on the internet, apparently it's a bit slow. But go to that site that I mentioned before, expecy, www.expecy.ch. You can Google it, and normally you should find it quickly. Come on. Ah, they changed apparently the URL meanwhile. It's .org now. So here you have quite a nice website, which here on the side gives you a whole set of software that allow you to do analysis of the protein that you chose. So if you click on this, you will have a huge list, see, of all sorts of software that you can use. And now the challenge for all of you is that with the protein that you had, you're basically gonna look a little bit what sort of things you could try out to actually identify or to get information on the gene. So there will be some blasts at some places. You have, for instance, string and prosite will look for protein domains. What else? Some will be a bit, maybe not too interesting. Here, for instance, you have BLAST. So, do you know BLAST? Did you ever use BLAST? Everybody in the back also? So, give it a try. Go to the NCBI BLAST. And basically, you copy-paste your sequence, and you run a BLAST. And BLAST is sort of the most popular software. Not really for bioinformatics, but we use it also, but for everybody. And it will look in a database. So basically, each time you publish a paper that concerns a gene, a sequence, something like that, you have to deposit it in public databases. NCBI is the one in the US, EBI is the one in Europe, and you also have a copy of the database in Japan. And so basically, that means that all the sequences that have been read, well, created or assembled or whatever, will end up in this database. It's even so that you cannot publish a paper about a new gene, for instance, without having submitted your sequence to this database. So you cannot publish a paper without sharing the sequence, at least the sequence of this gene. But it means that basically, those databases, they collect all possible proteins that all people, all researchers actually generate across the world. Also, for DNA, you have basically all the genomes that have been sequenced and are publicly available are in this database. So all those sequences are there. But that makes, of course, that those databases are quite big, most of the time even too big to run them locally. And also, so because it's a public database, so those are public databases, access is also completely free. And so run a BLAST, and normally you should see what sort of other organism the sequence you picked will show similarity to. So have, and then if you have something to write down, a piece of paper or something, write down or copy-paste the information in a text file or something like that. Copy-paste all the information that you collected. So, but don't copy-paste the whole blast. The bits and pieces that are contain information that might be interesting for you to sort of describe the gene. So I already mentioned here, Procyte, for instance, that you can try. Where is it? You have alignment softwares also. Here, if you have a gene, you also have software that will check whether you have a transit peptide that signals and targets the protein to a chloroplast. You can compute the molecular weight, PI of your protein. You can, and what you see, you also have some tools that yesterday we saw on the Galaxy. So you also have those tools here. So you can look for transmembrane domains, if there's any in the protein that you chose. Here again, another multiple alignment software. PFAM is also a very popular website to look for protein domains. Phobius is also one, but that will tell you whether you have transmembrane domains or signal peptides. This is one thing that you might also try out, but this you need to submit and give your email address, and it takes a while to process, so they will send you an email to download. And actually, this little utility will try to make a 3D structure of your protein based on a database of known structures. So it will try to align your protein against known structures. And if you have a perfect match, basically, this way you can even have the 3D structure. And typically the file that you will get, that you can, once you've done it, will come as a little 3D protein structure, so that you can rotate and things like that. So it's a bit fun. ProDom is also for protein domains, but that we saw already. RasMol is the software to see those 3D structures. Here, actually, to check whether your protein is being secreted. So if it's secreted, means that it has a target sequence that will tell you that the sequence goes outside of the cell and so has some action to do outside of the cell. Here, Sec2Logo. Yesterday, we already made logos. Also one thing is that if you do the blast, on NCBI, you can also select, for instance, the 10 best hits that you have, and then look a little bit on the website, because you will be able to... I don't have a protein, so does it work? Okay. So we can go to BLAST. Of course, you have... one thing for those that never used BLAST, you have different flavors. So you have the BLAST-N, which is typically against nucleotide databases, the BLAST-P against protein databases. The BLAST-X is when you submit a DNA sequence and you align it with protein databases. So it will tell you where the protein is located on, for instance, a genomic sequence. T-BLAST-N is you submit a protein and you align it against DNA, so you that's the reverse. And the T-BLAST-X is actually submitting a DNA sequence, checking comparing it with a database of other DNA, but do the comparison at the protein level. So you will do an automatic translation of both your, for instance, transcript DNA and the whole nucleotide database. A break? Okay.
Any program to looking for interaction between proteins? For example, in goats or something?
Like for ducking or something like that, or something like that that you're looking for? But because there is...
Roads of mutation into the cell.
That can predict protein-protein interaction or dimerization or something like that.
Yes.
I saw a software on this XPC, which was called sort of PEP or something like that. Here, for instance, also prediction of specific phosphorylation sites. You have here. Maybe it requires a little bit too much calculations to put it on a web server like this. Here, protein-protein interactions, maybe. You have a whole section actually.
Get the sequence of the protein. How do I get it? Because I.
Okay.
To select it from here, but the options.
It stays as a ghost. Which genome do you have?
The
normally, all the genes should be listed here. It's strange because other people have gene models. Okay. We can try another genome then, maybe. But here you have genes anyway. So those are the genes. And here you have the whole list, so you can.
But
you can jump from one gene to the other if you want.
Okay, so if I want to select one with a protein.
Yeah, you click on one of those genes. Okay, then you go to selection here. And before it was ghost, and now it's fine. So you can then take protein, and you can go directly to the NCBI for BLASTP, for instance.
Yeah, it's coming.
I forgot to... what's his name again? From yesterday. The Cuban. So the Cuban guy I met yesterday, Ionechis, asked me to, because I don't have his email or contact, to tell him that it's okay to meet with the people that he wanted me to meet at 5 o'clock tomorrow.
Keep telling me about it.
Yeah, so at 5 is okay. So you can confirm, if you could confirm. Where's this? Yeah. So you have a protein, so where's the gene? So if you click here, so you can, here, so those blue things here, these things, are the genes.
Okay.
And so if you select one, you can go to selection, and then you can translate it in a protein, and then you can go already right away to the BLASTP.
I was
from yesterday.
I was talking with my professor, and he told me that that we have another activity that we can do is try with differential plants to prove if it's an energetic.
One thing I should ask you first. So the NGS data that you have, is it targeted? So you sequence a very specific thing like with Stefania?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's also a tag that you that hybridizes and you sequence it from there.
Yeah.
That's the data that you have.
I have.
Yeah. So okay. Now, so that means that what I proposed yesterday is not okay. Because basically you have the same sort of data as Stefania. Mm-hmm. And what I would, and so the primer that you use to do the specific sequencing, is it specific for the, for what? For, it's targeting the fungus? Only? Only the fungus. Okay. And you double checked to see whether it can also hybridize somewhere on the what was it, coffee genome? Does it? I don't know. Can you find, could it be that, that you find it also in the coffee genome?
It could be that, but it has like a, you know, a limit to say if it's coffee or if it's a fungus.
But you're sure that you have coffee sequences?
I'm sure that you have.
If you're sure that you have coffee sequences, yeah, well, then still I would blast, for instance.
I was.
Yeah?
Yeah,
and then whatever is giving a good hit against the coffee genome or any other plants.
I check with blast.
Mm-hmm.
And
you have hits on.
On
coffee, so you have reads on coffee. So once you identify them, you can put them away because it's coffee and that's not what you want, right?
Yeah, my problem is with my husband, is with my fungi.
Mm-hmm.
Because either this fungi has geographic crisis.
They have one, sorry?
Geographic crisis.
Ah, that's the name of the fungus, okay.
Yeah. The problem is that I don't know if I have different allergies or if I have just one thing there. I don't know because.
Well, actually, then you should do something like I proposed to Stefania. Is if you make. So basically, you have many sequences and they all have the same beginning related to your to the tag, the primer that you used, and then it goes into the genome. Hmm? And if you do, you should try to cluster them because you will have way too many sequences to align them anyway. Because it's going to be like the problem I had yesterday with Stefania also, there's too many sequences. So as soon as you have more than 200 sequences and to align most of the time, it's very slow. If it actually results in anything, and most of the time it will crash. So that is not an option, because what you want to do is actually all those sequences, you want to cluster them. Mm-hmm. That's what you want to do.
But to have a lot of sequences, I have almost 40 sequences, maybe.
14? Only 14?
No,
40. 40, 40.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, then you can align them. And then the trick is to sort of... If you make a multiple alignment, basically the sequences that are the most similar will be clustered together. And then you can see how much variation you have across the different sequences that you have. Because this is what you want to look. So how many different sequences are there in your data set? That's what you're looking for, right? So if you make, so basically what you need to do is, and because you have not too many sequences, you could do an alignment and in order to cluster them. So the most similar, you could put together and so forth, and then depending on how many clusters you have, you could see how many, maybe that each cluster is related to a group or a species. But the only thing is, of course, is you will have maybe individual little differences that are linked to the individual, and at some point But at some point, maybe those differences are so big that it's maybe most likely another species. But you might have the problem that you cannot distinguish the little individual differences and actually the species. Because if they're too similar, they might be...
And an
easy way that you can do is if you do an cluster W, for instance. So that's an alignment program. Mm-hmm. And one of the output files is also a tree. It's not a phylogenetic tree, it's a sort of guiding tree that is used to help making the alignment. that guiding tree is also actually and will show you which clusters you have in your alignment.
Yeah, because
Okay.
And after I close my second mega to make paragon, and I take my tree and I apply bootstrap, which I want to
1,000 bootstraps, yeah. And then you obtain a nice tree. Which how many clusters do you have?
Two
major clusters. Yeah. So you maybe have two. Those might indicate the two organisms that you have, because the two big clusters that you have are the main. Well, basically it says that the cluster above and the cluster below, they're different. They have the most differences.
Yeah.
And then within each cluster, you probably will have the more individual little differences.
Yeah, I have.
So basically you have the information already. It's hard, but just based on this tree, it's hard. You cannot prove that you have two species, because it might be two subspecies or some. So that's a bit difficult. How could you have more information? Well, the only thing you know now is that you have two clusters. Whether those clusters are two different species. So one thing, but that requires more sequencing, of course.
Yeah.
Is that if you would sort of do this experiment on many coffees, and then you will have, and you see the same two clusters appearing, but morphologically you have three, something like that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and one of the two clusters, do you have two? If morphologically you have differences, so your fungus is quite different from the one which is in the NCBI database. Yeah. So, because if you only have one locus, it's not much. Mm? Based on one locus, you have two, but maybe if you would have looked at another locus, amplified something else, you might have the three, or you might have one. So it depends on how discriminative so having only one marker is quite limiting. Yeah, so basically the problem that you have is that someone looked at the data or looked at the organisms and could identify three different morphotypes, and you on a molecular basis you only find two. So given that you only used one marker, it's very limiting, so you should have more markers. The more, the better, the more resolution you will have. And then maybe one of the two that you have now might fall apart into more Tutsuk. Then, I know that in Germany, they've been busy sequencing a spider. But I don't know whether the data is published or out. I haven't seen a paper about it. So, also the scorpion has been done. So with the chelicerates you have the scorpion and the acari for the moment.
How do you know which genes are the ones that are in charge to codify for venom?
By using all those tools, because it should be a secreted protein. So maybe there's some sequences that are related to some known venoms that were maybe sequenced somewhere. So this way you could sort of screen the whole genome to see which venoms are potentially there. But otherwise it would be a secreted protein, for sure. Yeah, I don't know what sort of domains you should expect in those proteins. So maybe by doing blasts and comparing a lot, you might find some protein. And the trick that you can do is that you can screen a whole genome, and you might find one gene in that spider genome or so. Because of homology, you can use the first gene that you found in the genome and blast that one against the whole genome to see whether you have more hits. Given that they probably will occur in gene families, you will, if you find one and you blast that one that you find again against the genome, you should find all the others. But the spider mite has no venom, as far as I know. So they don't have venom. They eat plants, so they don't need to kill their prey. But the genome for the spider mites, that one is available. So that one you can find on our website. So you will find Tetramycus urticae, which is the spider mites, which we already published and which is available. So if you want to look at this one, that's the closest data around, the closest to spiders, basically. But spiders, I haven't seen. But the problem is that spiders are not easy to work with because they're cannibals. So you cannot put them all together. So each one needs to have his own box. Also when you have, for a bigger spider it might work, but for a small spider, like the spider mites, it's like the head of a needle. It's tiny, tiny, tiny. You need to inbreed it. So that means you need to cross the males with the mother a couple of times in order to inbreed it, so that the complexity of the genome is reduced and makes it easier to assemble and to work with. But with spiders, it's not easy because in some species, for instance, the offspring eats the mother, or the mother dies after giving birth to the, and then you cannot do inbreeding anymore. And that makes the whole assembly of spiders quite difficult. But as technology advances, maybe at some point it will be possible. Why are you interested in spiders?
I'm interested because of the venom. It may have medical properties. Okay. And the venom. Well, I think in our country, there have been...
Tea or coffee? Coffee, yeah.
There haven't been many studying spiders here. So there are some, and I used to work, I worked for 2 years with them, but there is not much information, and it's considered, I think, more unique molecules that you can get from spiders.
1 million proteins from one spider?
From all of them.
From all the spiders together.
I think they are very interesting.
I find it a bit of pity that in those countries like Ecuador, but you have other countries also, you have such diversity of things. But then you don't have the money or the possibility to actually look at it. So you have the spider and bam, I don't have money or the machines to actually look at it. So it's not so much, but then it needs to be in collaborations. Huh? You can do the biology and the whole DNA extraction and all those kind of things, which is also not easy, very important. And then you can have it assembled somewhere else or some other people can help with the analysis. Then.
Did you know that? From the spider venom,
they've
taken some molecules to cure for the treatment of muscular dystrophy.
Really? And it works?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's
working. Okay. Before a molecule hits the market, it takes easily 10 to 15 years. So.
Yeah.
All those tests need to be so secure that it takes so much time.
It has been tested, spider venom, it helps in the treatment of
another disease.
No, but it is the disease that main usually face erectile dysfunction. It has been studied for that.
Okay.
And, there are some drugs that the venom can be more effective diseases, especially the pain, chronic diseases like cancer, it is more effective. And it requires less doses.
Okay, and less dependency maybe. You don't become dependent on them. But also try to keep track of those websites. They might be interesting for you at any point in the future maybe. So now we're gonna talk a little bit about the gene prediction softwares. So here you have a few of those software. Oops, wrong button. Here. So you have quite some different methods. And I was already talking this morning about those methods that were used from the language research. So, and those are typically the GMMs, HMMs. And so some of those software, well, the bold ones, are still actively supported and developed. So this is one from developed in Germany, this one in Spain, this one is in the US, this one is also in the US, and this one is actually the one that we developed in collaboration with people in France, specialists in artificial intelligence. And so basically, here, the way I divide them all is based on the underlying major algorithm. So there's those HMMs and so on. Here, on the other side of the border, you have actually I don't know if you can call them really gene predicting software, although they do predict genes, but they basically rely almost entirely on extrinsic data, so basically on mapped molecules. Certainly Maker is quite popular in the US. The ones below, so TwinScan, Twain, and all those kind of other ones, are a sort of they have some rudimentary statistical models, or at least knowledge about gene structures, but actually mostly rely again on alignments with other genes. And the software that we use, Eugene, is actually a software that we developed back again in the 90s, and it's not very popular, and it's not very popular because it's so hard to learn to use it, because it has pages and pages of parameters, so you really have to know how it works. But with those parameters, once you know how to use it, allows you to actually incorporate a lot of extrinsic data. So it can do prediction completely ab initio, like the programs on the left, but it can also exploit alignments with proteins, with other genomes, with ESTs. It's even so that when we developed it, we made it so versatile that when RNA-seq came out, we didn't even have to rewrite the program or anything. We could use RNA-seq right away. Typically, if you have one of those at the left, this is how basically a model, a prediction software works. It's a pity I don't you? Is anybody having my laser on his desk or something? No, it's while walking around. Maybe I left it on someone's desk. No? Okay. Yeah, but I don't find it. Or did I put it? Ah, there it is. Found it. Basically, the start point is here in the middle. And if you see it, basically what you have up and down is the same thing. It's the same structure. And simply it's because in order to make your software efficient, you want to read the sequence in one direction and treat both strands in one go. You don't want to predict one strand and then the other strand. And basically, what's in a circle are signals, and like the start and the stop. You have here the three reading frames for the exons. This is for a non-coding gene. Then in order to go from a start, for instance, so you're reading the sequence, you see a start, and then you have to choose between the different reading frames. So suppose we go for this reading frame, then we have an exon, we stay there until we find a donor. Once we have a donor, we can go to an intron until we go into an exon, go to another, an acceptor. With the acceptor, you have the beginning of an exon again, that goes to a donor, again to an intron, an acceptor, again to some exon, again a donor, intron, and so forth. And you follow all those arrows until you end up in a stop codon. And so each circle or square is actually a program, a model that you have to, that will produce some scores across the sequence. So Eugene, the software, as I said, is from last century, highly flexible to integrate basically anything of extrinsic data, but as I said, it's really complex to master. But the big advantage, and that's why on the first, with those big circles there, the green circles, I put it in the middle, because the software that were on the left, they do only prediction. The softwares that were on the right, they can also sometimes use one of the software that was on the left, but basically they try to fix gene models a posteriori using alignments. Well, this software, from the beginning, was actually developed in order to be informed even before it starts to make a prediction. So the software knows where you have protein alignments, knows where there's RNA-seq actually mapping on the genome, and all this information combined with the ab initio models allows to make more reliable predictions. So up to now, we have even more than 40 tracks to incorporate prior knowledge, so basically extrinsic data. So as I said, it's an a priori informed system. So that means that the ab initio part is informed about whatever is around. It knows where there's ESTs, cDNAs, proteins, homology, things like that. And it puts all this in a graph, in a DAG, directional acyclic graph. And basically each track, so that's one of those 40 tracks, will, and each dot here represents a nucleotide, and for instance, an HMM will score the coding potential, and will tell that, for instance, here, let's start here, basically we don't have any good scoring coding potential. So basically the scores here are low for coding potential. And then we have good coding potential here, but that means that we need to change tracks, and the only way to change tracks is through signals, like a donor or an acceptor. And basically, if this is possible, and you have a high-scoring track here, the software will basically jump to that track and keep on going until it finds a stop codon or donor and then an acceptor and so on. So here it's a very... But it's the same thing as this kind of complex web of software that was shown before. Because we can use it as an integrator. We start with the genomic sequence. We can map whatever expression data, RNA-seq, from whatever technology available. If there are ESTs, we can map the ESTs. In the case it's a plant, so TER10, that's the Arabidopsis, 10th version. We can map the proteins or simply the curated proteins of SwissProt. So depending on the data, we use several software. So this is a mapper for short reads. This one will map proteins taking into account intron exon borders. And this is simply the BLASTx. Of course, as I said before, genome of plants have a lot of repeats. So, and a repeat here, in repeat I mean transposable elements. Transposable elements are selfish pieces of DNA that replicate themselves in a genome. So they have all the genes in order to excise themselves out of a genome or copy themselves in a genome and insert themselves somewhere else in a genome. So it's a bit like a virus or something like that. But they never become a virus. So, and you find them in all plants, even in human. So we find those repeats also in humans. And of course, we can predict a little bit of non-coding genes. Then, as you can see here, I listed a couple of softwares that are commonly used. Also, this information we can integrate. And then we put everything in this software, and it spits out the CDS, CDNAs, that we translate, and then we can do gene families, we can do functional annotation, and produce a human-readable functional description. So basically, we have automated the whole pipeline in order to predict genes. The advantage of combining information, you can see here. So here you have a number, this is on Medicago, Truncatula, but some of those software were actually only available on Arabidopsis, so it's not the ideal case, and they were not trained on Medicago. But you see, the both are higher plans, it still worked, at least for the exon level, so that's sensitivity. So that is in to what extent you're able to see the exons. And specificity is to what extent the exons that you see are actually correct. And this is for the genes. But you see, you only have like a quarter of the genes that you can predict properly if you use an improperly trained software. Depending on the software, sometimes it's a bit better. But here you see the software trained on Arabidopsis, trained on Medicago, you see already an increase of the quality, although sometimes it's marginal. So if we train our software, if you see, it's not the best one. It's not a bad one, but if we start to combine everything together, we actually, so here we integrated this one, we integrated protein similarity and transcripts, and basically we end up with 80%. But as I said before, our system is quite flexible, so we didn't have to rewrite the software in order to incorporate RNA-seq, but RNA-seq is you cannot just dump it and see what comes out of it. So we had to do a little bit of testing in how to provide the RNA-seq. So one of the quite popular ways that many other softwares also do is to preassemble the RNA-seq so that you have contexts that represent the transcripts, and then you treat them like ESTs, full-length cDNAs, that you map on a genome. The problem is that when you do this sort of assembly, is that you easily can end up with chimeric assemblies. That means that if you have two genes recently duplicated, they will share so much sequence similarity that they might be fused, or they might be basically a micmac of both genes, which makes it basically impossible to properly map them back on the genome, basically trick the software in order to make a prediction. So that's what I was saying, so chimeric. If you have a very dense genome, typically if you a small bacteria, well, not a bacteria then, but a small algae, small spider mites, like here, this Aculops, the genes are so close to each other, and even in those picoalgae, they're so close, and they even actually overlap. So that the end of a gene overlaps the end of another gene. And if you build contigs using the RNA-seq, given that those genes overlap, the RNA-seq will be basically as one big contig. And for instance, with this Aculops, this mite, that they were doing this in Amsterdam, and they were unable to predict genes because they were assembling the RNA-seq, mapping it to the genome, and basically they had huge transcripts and no genes or too many genes and stuff like that, and it was a mess. So this is a problem that you have with very dense genes. What you can also have, and this is in insects, we've seen this quite regularly, is that we have genes in the introns of other genes. So it's not, and actually, and this is quite a problem, because if we go back, basically in order to start a gene, you have to be at this place in the whole schema. But as soon as you enter the schema, the only way to go back is to go through a stop. So basically, if you have another gene in a gene, and a gene that you're already predicting, there's no way you will be able to predict it. And no software can actually handle genes in other genes. So there's no possibility here. So that means that if you have that, you will automatically predict one of the genes, or maybe you will break a gene in order to be able to predict the next one, and so forth. Also, with the RNA-seq, we saw that much more is transcribed, and a lot is actually never translated, and also you have antisense genes. And the antisense genes can have a totally different splice structure that is basically in conflict with the genes that you want to predict, the protein coding genes, for instance. And so that basically also there, it creates a mess. So in order to integrate, the best solution that we found was to only consider the junctions. And the junctions are, from the RNA-seq, when you map them, that they have a little piece of the RNA of your read is mapping at one place, and the other part of the read is mapped somewhere else. The part where it maps is exon, the part in between is intron. And actually, once you know where the introns are, it's easy to predict the exons. They're just next to it. So in that sense, this way we could really improve a lot our predictions and obtain good results. But it's not perfect, I'm telling you, because if you do this, you depend on a good mapper. If your mapping software is a bit crappy, well, crap in, crap out. So it's a bit a problem. Also, in order to avoid over prediction, a software like TopHat will only consider the most canonical splice site, which is okay for 90-95% of the genes, but there's other software that basically allow much more different types of donors and acceptors, but then basically the problem is that you get so much false positive that it's actually not even usable. So we stick to TopHat or GSNAP. But then it's of course there's a way to exploit a little bit more of the RNA-seq, and that is basically by having a stranded RNA-seq. Nowadays, stranded RNA-seq is a default. If you go to a provider and ask for an RNA-seq experiment, basically it will be by default it will be stranded. So that's fine. And with these, you can do still some assemblies of RNA-seq into context. One other thing that we also saw is that, again, this is a consequence of the mapper, is that if the read extends a tiny little bit in the intron, it will not be spliced to put this little bit where it should belong, but it tries to put it somewhere else most of the time without any intron, so that gives some background noise. And then also, as I said, RNA-seq reports much more stuff which gets transcribed, so we have to be able to also have the option to have non-protein coding genes. It doesn't get stuck in absolutely trying to make a protein coding gene. Yeah, this is maybe a bit technical things, so we added, in order to make it easier, we added some keywords in order to label the data a bit better with the RNA-seq. So if you would represent what the software is seeing, so basically this is the same thing as this directional acyclic graph, but now it's basically plotting all the scores. So here you have the scores of the intergenic, and here you have intron. The blue ones here are ESTs, or transcripts. The pink is a donor, the green is an acceptor, the start codon is in blue, and the stop codons are in red. And here, typically, you see that you have a higher coding potential, so you score well here. Oh, yeah, and the gray thing here that you see is those are protein alignments. So basically, with all this information, the software could find easily all the different exons that are shown here in red. And basically you have an exon, intron, exon, and so forth, until you reach, where is the stop codon here? And then you go back and intergenic. But prediction is only prediction. And here you see an example of the evolution of the annotation on rice and on Arabidopsis. So basically when it came out, Arabidopsis had less genes than it had in 2006. And while rice overpredicted way too much, they overpredicted way too much, and they only cleaned up and decreased the genes. The number of genes in plants, if they are diploid, of course, fluctuates around these numbers. So if you have smaller organisms like those algae, they will have much less, like around 10,000 genes. If you go for polyploids, of course, then you double the amount of genes, and you can have a lot of genes in that case. So a way to sort of evaluate how good and the final prediction is by, if you have, this is the case of Vitis, so the grapevine, and Arabidopsis as a reference. If we take, we do a blast P, of all the proteins from Vitis against the proteins of Arabidopsis, and in order to evaluate whether the gene prediction was okay, first, it needs to be, we take the best hit, so the best protein, the protein that aligns best against the Vitis protein, and the ratio of the length of those proteins should be very, very similar. It's impossible to have two similar genes where one is twice as long as the other one. And so basically, the genes that are in those three bins, we consider as being successfully predicted. In the first bin here, we have tiny little predictions, small genes, etc., but also all the genes that are not present in Arabidopsis. Here you have genes that are typically missing an exon, so basically a gene which is predicted here, almost good, might have an exon in this bin that should have been connected in order to enter in this bin. On the other side are fused genes, so basically genes that were predicted together, and in this particular case we see that we did quite a good job. Okay, some examples. So this is a screenshot from the same software that you saw before. And here we have typically an example of a gene predicted in another gene. So you have a number of exons here, and then a large intron that goes beyond the screen. And you have another gene which itself has exons in introns sitting actually in the intron of this particular gene. And you see that both are nicely covered by RNA-seq. Here, the green and blue means where the read maps. The pink are the junctions, so the connecting, to connect two pieces of a read. So you should have pink where you have an intron. I told you about dense genomes. This is a wasp, a small parasitic wasp. You see that basically you have genes all over the place. So if you would assemble the RNA-seq, you would basically fuse the whole thing together and not being able to predict anything that makes sense. And you see the genes are highly spliced and tiny little exons, so quite complicated and challenging genome. Now that we have the genome, we annotated it, we have gene models on the genome. So what the next thing that we can do is comparative genomics. So basically, comparative genomics is has everything to do with evolution, where basically we know that every organism has an ancestor, and that if you go far enough backwards in time, that you will end up with an the oldest common ancestor, for instance. But that means that you can actually also study the structures. Basically, what happens when you go with genomes is that because genomes are quite flexible, certainly plants, they can really rearrange bits and pieces of the genome. They can easily have, as I said already, mentioned already before, also polyploids and all those reorganization of the genome basically leads to different, of course, genotypes, but also to phenotypes. This can have quite this sort of flexibility and reorganization can have quite a lot of implications, among which regulation. If you transpose a gene from one place to the other in the genome in a completely natural way, it can have quite a drastic effect on expression. But still, if you look at orthologs, so orthologs are genes that are having the same function across different organisms, while paralogs are genes that are a member of the same gene family, but within the same genome. Basically, if you compare and you look at different genomes, you will focus mainly on orthologs. Basically, every genome that you're looking at some point will have a common ancestor. So basically, if you're working on a certain genome, if you're lucky, you have something close by. If you're less lucky, it will be far away, and therefore informative. So basically, applications that you have with comparative genomics is in the annotation. So that's basically all the extrinsic information that you can exploit from other genomes. You can look at genome evolution. So basically, that's looking at homologous genomic regions through collinearity. And one other thing, which is very often done, certainly with crops, is looking for conserved non-coding regions, because those are to some extent linked to binding sites of transcription factors. For genome evolution, I will not talk anymore about prediction because that's done. Basically, if you have very close organisms, you can align them. Typically, and I will show you an example, mouse and human, basically, they're very close to each other. So you can align quite a lot of pieces back to the genome, to each other's genomes. And the other, and this is of course at the nucleotide level, so this is quite detailed and quite high resolution. Of course, you can go intergenomic, but also intra, because again, given that plants can modify or duplicate their genome relatively easy, because most of the crops actually are polyploids, most of the plants that we eat are polyploids. You can also look at regions within the genome and sort of trying to trace back parts of the genome that were the result of the integration of an older genome duplication. And if you go to a much less deeper level, you can use genetic markers, physical maps, to actually compare. And then certainly within the grasses, collinearity is very high. So the markers from barley and other tritium quite close. So you see that really, although they're really different species, the order of the markers remained well conserved. Syntony, this is based on gene content. So basically here you look for regions where the order and the content of the genes remain the same. And I will go a little bit more. Collinearity, that's only gene content and order. So, then you have also DNA-based and base-to-base. So those are the different levels of resolution. And when we look at the evolution, we saw that actually most of the organism that we study underwent a whole genome duplication. Also humans. So basically, humans in a long time ago, I will say, because the biggest one was when vertebrates were only fish, so they were not mammalians yet. But and what we see is that we can see that actually the linked to massive extensions, like with the dinosaurs, when the meteorite hit what is now the Gulf of Mexico and wiped out a lot of the animals and the organisms that were on the Earth, is that at that moment we can date, although with a big margin of error, we can date the most recent genome duplications in many organisms, mostly in plants. We looked at plants, 40 plants, and most of them basically show that they had a whole genome duplication in the in the period that the meteorite hit the Earth. And the reason is polyploids, because those genome duplications that we can still see now are a consequence of sort of condensing a polyploid, were present, and they are present basically all the time. It's something that easily happens in plants, having a polyploid. But the problem is that when they are in sort of the general conditions and the environment is like, there's not too challenging, they will have to compete with all the diploids. The diploids are in the majority. And this, because of that, because they're in the majority, the polyploids have a hard time to find a partner to actually, with which they can make seeds. Basically, that means that polyploids in completely normal conditions tend to disappear. Or, well, disappear, they will be recreated, and so you have a cycle basically of disappearing and appearing. That is sort of continuous. But as soon as you change the environment in a dramatic way, those polyploids, sometimes because they have the double amount of genes, they sometimes grow faster. Typically, when you go to the Arctic, most of the plants in the Arctic are polyploids. And it is simply an adaptation to actually grow very fast. Basically, you have the double amount of proteins, so the whole machinery can work twice as fast. Because of that, those plants can actually grow in the very short summer, grow, make flowers, make seeds, and by the time the winter is there, basically everything is done. And the seeds are there for the next generation. So there, under harsh conditions, you will find more polyploids. Another way to concentrate polyploids is humans, because again, they have some sort of better vigor. They will be selected by humans. The seeds are bigger, for instance. So you will basically try to keep those plants that have bigger seeds, and you will basically sow them again and again and again, and you will always keep the ones that have the bigger seeds. So over thousands of years, you're able to, from maybe you have a little corns that are tiny little things that are basically useless to eat almost, but now you have huge corns, and it's all through human selection. And those are also polyploids. But to come again to the genome duplications, is that so, because it requires a lot of energy to keep those duplicated genomes, what you see is that basically the genome, the plant, the ancestral plant that had its genome duplicated, will sort of by accident lose bits and pieces. It's okay because you have everything in double. So if you lose an arm of a chromosome for some reason, there's no problem because you still have an arm of that chromosome from the other genome. That's from your doubled genome. So in that sense, you can sort of reorganize the whole genome and reduce it again to a diploid with time. And what you also see is that, like here, and great moments in evolution were actually linked with a genome duplication, is that the dicot plants, apparently for many of them, have, as I said before, have had this sort of whole genome duplication. And depending on which piece you were losing and restructuring, actually you were not able to cross again with the other ones that lost another piece. Because at some point you lose compatibility. And this way you have, after genome duplication, you can have an explosion of species. Of course, spread over millions of years. But after genome duplication, because you have so much more material to play with, you can actually start to invent new pathways in order to create new tissues, new structures. And this way, we see that a lot of big jumps in architecture of plants are correlated with massive genome duplication. Some plants, though, didn't go through genome duplications, but what you see is that they have a lot of tandem duplications. So basically, they go small scale and then amplify their genes. One of those is Vitis. Vitis is basically a plant that didn't do too much genome duplication. So only had two genome duplication in their history. Here, this is a way to sort of visualize those genome duplications. Here what you do is a KS plot. KS plot means that you align all the codons of all the genes that you have. Of course, you have to do the alignment at protein level and back translate it to the original DNA in order to do it properly. And what you count is the number of synonymous substitutions. So that means that you have a codon, you change one nucleotide, but it will produce still the same amino acid. So basically, that means that at the protein level, nothing changes, while on the DNA level, small changes happen. And those are changes that are sort of easily manageable because you don't change anything at the protein level. And if you do this for all the proteins here in our biopsies, basically you see that, this ratio is called the KS. If you plot all those ratios, you see that basically you have really two clear peaks. And then when a colleague did some fitting, so basically we tried to fit a curve on this plot, we see that we need actually three different curves, which means that it's a proof, it's a mathematical sort of proof that we're dealing with three genome duplications. So given that we have genome duplications and our biopsies went through the whole genome duplication, but reduced its genome again to a diploid, basically what we want to try to find is to what extent we can sort of find the ancestral or how the genome was restructured. So basically, the original genome had, so this is, each box here is a gene, and it's along a piece of DNA. We have a whole genome duplication, but through rearrangement, evolution, etc., some genes jump to other places, you lose some genes are inserted, and so forth, so you have this whole flexibility going on. What we do is we use the software, IDOR actually, and basically it looks for all those collinear regions in a genome. And it's quite fast, certainly the last version, and you can sort of really look for collinear regions across like 50 genomes without exploding your computer or waiting for weeks. If you do it just internally, so in our biopsies, if you would only look for the internal duplication in our biopsies, it just takes a few seconds. But the whole principle is that for each basically segment or for each genome or something like that, you basically make a list of all the genes and you make a matrix. And then you use very simply BLASTP in order to look for genes that have similarity. So basically, gene 1 on this section and gene 1 on this section have homology. 4 is homolog with 4, 6 with 6, 7 with 7, and so forth. So basically, the genes that are on the diagonal, or more or less on the diagonal, are the ones that show synteny. And this is how you do it. And then basically, yeah, you have this whole matrix with all sorts of little dots. And then you need to do some more statistics in order to sort of filter away all those isolated little gene pairs. And what you're going for is a diagonal. Because genes can be inserted or deleted, this diagonal is not perfectly straight. That's why you have some waves. So how did it work? We have, and actually, yeah, so an extension that we did on the software is that you can look pretty easily to simple recent duplications. But if you want to look further, what we've done is that suppose we have this duplicated segment, and what is white is either lost or, well, doesn't give a hit, so can be a lost gene or an inserted gene. And the ones in purple are the ones that kept similarity and order. And basically, if you compare one, so segment A with segment C, you see this is not significant. You only have three genes, so that can be a pure coincidence. If you do with the same segment, you compare segment B, again, it's not very significant. But if we make from those two a profile, actually, what we see, and a profile, and we look again across the whole genome with this profile, we actually can find something which is with increased specificity. So we can have more genes that actually map with the profile than with each sequence. And this way we can actually crawl back in time, because each time we find a hit, we can incorporate it to the model or the profile that we built, and this way look even further and have more and more degenerated regions in a genome that we can sort of find back. So here you see we have a pair, we make a profile, we find a third one, we include a third one, make a new profile, and this way we can keep on looking each time older and older regions. Basically, this is what, like one example in our biopsies, where the lines show basically the oldest regions that were still detectable in our biopsies. So for the 5 chromosomes. Oh, yeah, those are other regions, actually. Consequence of genome duplication is that is the fate of the genes. Again, given that you have the double amount of genes, you can easily start to experiment if you duplicate. And if you duplicate it more, you even have more material. And this way, you can, for instance, either lose... So the small boxes are promoter elements, and the big box is the gene. So you can differentially lose, for instance, a promoter element. But given that you have the two genes, the combination of the two basically can still fulfill all the tasks. So in this way, you can sort of slowly, of course, over millions of years, evolve and sort of modify the expression of some genes. This way, make some pathways specific for some tissues. And once this is happening, basically, you can fine-tune the same pathways in those different tissues. And this way you can, and so basically here again, this is with maize underwent also a whole genome duplication. So, and rice, oh, well, an extra one, maize got an extra one, rice went all the way, stayed as it was. Through millions of years of evolution, basically we lost a lot of genes, but still, like here, we can find genes that are basically orthologs. And because we can find orthologs with rice, and we can find it at several places, so we have quite a lot of microcollinearity between rice and maize, we can actually go and find little conserved regions that, because you have some genes, so the red things here are genes, the greens are the exons, but we can also find other regions that are slightly conserved across the genome. Also, when we compare lost, so normally it's rice and maize, or rice is in the middle. So this is the genetic map of rice, and the two regions of maize basically also show this micro collinearity. Also, as I said before, human and mouse. Well, we don't look alike, but our genome is not that different, except that you have a lot of restructuration. So basically, here you have each column is a human chromosome, and the colors represent the different chromosomes from mouse. And you see that you have large regions that basically stayed conserved between mouse and human. So we're not that different here. Another way to view it, to look at it, is with genetic markers, where basically we see that on the human, we can actually find back mouse markers. And that makes actually mouse as a good model for a lot of research on human, like cancer and things like that. Because we can, from a mouse, we can go back to human and then see what sort of differences can be observed. You have a browser, so this is another browser for the human genome. So an alternative of the one that you opened before. And again, you see so there's some human, mouse, and rat, and chicken. I don't know exactly which tracks, but anyway, even with birds, we still chirp quite a lot. And it's even so that at some places, you can actually align the DNA. So much conserved. So really, we're not that different. But every little gap that you see here, if this would be like an intergenic region, and I think the blue ones are exons, so this is the promoter, and this is the beginning of a gene, you see how much is still conserved at the promoter level. And typically, the promoter level, or the promoter sequence, there's no constraint to keep absolutely the DNA as it is. So basically here, in the coding part, you need to make sure that you code for the same protein. So there's some constraints here. You cannot just mutate in all sorts of things and do crazy things, because if you do, you will lose the gene and you will lose the protein. While on the non-coding part, like introns, you have much more flexibility, and it's okay to lose a little piece here and there, as long as the regions that are important are conserved. And so this way, we can actually, by using comparative methods, actually find back motifs that might be linked to regulation. If you go for all those different conserved regions between human and mouse, well, you see how much conservation. So the most conservation you will have are, so it's only non-coding pieces, basically. So the genes, maybe it was here, I don't know, but it would be like a huge peak. But you see that within UTRs, untranslated regions, you have quite a lot of conservation. Basically, you have quite a lot of conservation. This is another way, another place, again, where you see the conservation between mouse and human. And this part here, this plot, gives you the percentage identity, so all over the place. And you see that where you have exons, basically identity goes up, but identity never goes completely down in most cases. So what can we learn? And this is also something that we now are able to do more and more, is to do sort of the same experiment on different organisms. Like we did an experiment where we were looking at what are the core genes that are active when a pest is attacking the plant. And if we were looking at one plant, in the beginning was Arabidopsis, basically we didn't figure out nothing. We couldn't make a story out of it, it was not possible. And then we did the same experiment on tomato, and then suddenly, well, about a bit more than 100 genes sort of started to emerge. And when we added Vitis, basically the core was 39 genes. And that is simply because when you do these comparisons, each time you have each genome, each individual will have its own battery of genes in order to cope with the pest. And those are specific for each species. And unfortunately, many of those genes are simply unknown. That's why we were not able to make a story out of it. Combining them, basically you lose or you discard every individual thing that is linked to a certain species of plants. And by doing so, you eliminate everything which is not the core. So we have the core, and now the idea is to actually look in more just to solana say. So to see, okay, what do solana say do? And this way you can combine a tomato, potato, nightshade, or many other solana say. And then you will have, again, the core, but a number of extra genes that are typical for solana say. The general. Also, when we compare grasses, it's always good to have a model organism, and in this case, when you look at grasses, your model will be either rice or what's the name again? A smaller, but rice is basically the more common model plant for the grasses, and it makes it much more easy to work on rice than to work on all the others that have all those genome duplications and extensions of their genome. Because if you want to make a knockout of a gene or a knock-in, basically it's easier to do it with rice because you don't have all this redundancy of genes. If you have genome duplications and you knock out a gene, basically on the other genome, the gene will be still there and will still be able to do its job. Again, collinearity is very high between the grasses. So, and if you have this plot, so this is the same plot as with this IDOR software. Basically, you see for each chromosome to what extent showing up here and there. And here you have another representation of the different grasses with basically where each arc represents a chromosome and the corresponding chromosomes in the other genomes. If you go more in detail, you see even also here more micro collinearity, and by comparing all those genomes, you basically can sort of redraw the whole history. You can actually make even phylogenetic plots based on those structures. Not only, so basically here you look at really more global and you're not focusing on a gene or a couple of genes. And so you can see all the restructurations that can go on in across the different grasses. Here, another example of pieces that were translocated and then diverged in order to make sorghum and then other things that happened. So the original maize was an allotetraploid, and basically that had all sorts of effects on the gene content and gene structure. And this way, you can again crawl back in time and sort of have the sort of an in silico paleontology of genome structures. And certainly with transposable elements, because they're so much spread over the different genomes.